Thank you all for coming here today to this wonderful conference. It is my great privilege to be addressing you. I'll start off by saying that I really appreciate the wonderful case studies which were presented today that showcased so much innovation in different walks of life. However, I have some bad news. Despite all the wonderful things that you've seen, the world faces an innovation crisis of unprecedented proportions. Now, you might be surprised when I say that. How can, after all, you know, seeing connected cities, you know, such amazing, you know, innovations in Internet of Things, how can you say that innovation is in a crisis? Well, I'll actually say that the reason why I believe that is so is because in the last 15 to 20 years, there have been no major breakthroughs, really, in the areas where that really count, such as healthcare, education, and governance. And that's only part of the, you know, part of the problem. If you look at, say, the way we live, for example, housing, have you really seen significant innovation in that over the last 20-25 years? Have you seen, for example, completely new type of building being made? Or have you seen, for example, a disruption in the way we travel, air travel? It still takes the same amount of time, if not more, to travel between two cities. Why can't we, for example, fly from Calcutta to San Francisco in 2 hours? You know, if you remember the movie 2010, A Space Odyssey, the visions that were propounded by the great science fiction authors were that of space travel, and they also talked about creation of artificial life. Well, we are nowhere close to that today, you know. So unfortunately, what we have really seen over the last 15, 20 years is more incrementalism rather than disruption. And I want to actually touch a little bit about why that is the case. Because fundamentally, you know, we've talked of innovation in terms of products and in terms of things. But what it actually is it's a state of mind. It's actually a way of thinking. And we need to ask ourselves is how much do we actually think about innovation, or how much do we actually think about innovating in our day-to-day lives? Because if you really see, I mean, I don't see that happening on a regular basis for most people. And of course, that mindset actually trickles down into businesses and the way they operate. So ultimately, people think, okay, is this a good thing to do once in a while? But on a regular basis, that's not really the thing. So I want to actually center my presentation around the need to innovate. Why should we innovate? What is the importance of innovation? And some examples of how a culture of innovation can be instituted within your organizations. Firstly, I'd like to ask you, what do you think innovation means to you? What is innovation? Can anyone hazard a guess? Or can anyone answer that? An improvement. Okay. I think probably if you really see, most of your answers might fall in the first three categories. Either it's a new product, a new process, maybe a new technology, which I think we've seen in a lot of the cases. Maybe it's a new idea. But actually what it is, if you really think about it, it's all of these. You know, it's all of these. It's not any one of these. It's all of these. But really, it centers around a new way of thinking. It's actually a new way of thinking, which means that at the core of innovation is not really a product or an idea, but it's actually the need to think differently, really. And that is where it actually starts. Now, if you look at the human species, what makes us human, really? If you really see, what makes us different from, let's say, an ape, for example? I believe it's not really intelligence. Intelligence is actually, you know, overrated. I think everything is intelligent. You know, even, for example, this computer can be called an intelligent device, you know. So what is the difference between this machine and between us? It's actually, I believe, what makes the human being human is a level of dissatisfaction with the status quo. In other words, there is no other species in the world which is so uncomfortable with this current situation. And therefore, if you look at our DNA of what makes us human, it is to challenge the status quo. And this particular picture, this image is from this movie called The Rise of the Planet of the Apes, which is a fairly successful movie over the last 4 or 5 years. And it was a remake of an older film from the 60s. And in this movie, this primordial ape becomes human. And actually, the point at which this ape becomes human is the point at which it decides that its situation in life, which is under captivity, under the captivity of humans, is not tenable. So therefore, it is at that point when it becomes human-like. The humanity is not centered around consciousness in that sense, but it's centered around its ability to see itself within its wider surroundings and to realize that it is actually hemmed in. Hence, I actually see that within the human being, there's an unlimited capacity for disruption. And that is actually the DNA, the DNA of innovation itself. So now I'll go back to the question, why innovate? If you really see the great innovations that we know of, like the personal computer, the telephone, electricity, and so on and forth, there was really no physical need for them as such. You know, it's not like, you know, someone did a market research, a survey, and said that, okay, we need an automobile, or we need electricity, or we need a telephone. You know, there was no survey back then. But what was there was, again, that the inventors or the proponents, they felt that there needed to be a change. There needed to be a transformation in the environment around them. There needed to be a disruption. And that's what actually triggered all of this. It wasn't really triggered by a need. And that's where I think we really come upon. We must differentiate between an incremental improvement and between an innovation, fundamentally. Now, if you can really see that the need, why I will actually now center around why is the need for this so stronger today than ever before. Paradoxically, while the need is stronger, it is actually going down, you know. The world is changing fundamentally in an important sense. What is changing about the world is that if you really looked at what drove the old world, and by the old world I mean the world before, let's say, before the internet came in, you know, in that sense. So you say mid-90s or so. And I'm talking about the global context, but India, of course, is very much a part of this. There were three elements which drove the old world, which was legacy, which basically meant that you were destined to follow in your father's footsteps in a certain sense, or let's say your family. And if, let's say, your family was your family was in the carpentry business, then you would actually become a carpenter. So professions, knowledge were actually handed down the line through generations. The other factor which I think drove the old world was the dynamics of power and the struggles of power. So whoever could actually move up the hierarchies and would attain control would actually change or set the rules of the game, in a sense, whether it was in corporations or governments and so on and so forth. And the third factor which drove the world was tribalism. So where you came from mattered a lot, you know, not really where you did. So I'll give an example. In India, for instance, you know, in most of the media companies, I don't know if you knew, but there was an unwritten rule in journalist news departments that you have to have Brahmins in the news departments. You know, in many, many actually media companies practice this. And the reason why this was the case was because of, you know, the association of knowledge with that community. In the same sense, if you really think, if you look at, let's say, a famed international MNC like McKinsey, for example, you know, McKinsey had a policy which was, again, unwritten, but internally it was very well circulated, that they would only hire from, say, 3 or 4 Ivy League universities, you know, and then I think over a period of time they sort of expanded that network to include maybe a few first-year institutes in the U.S. But in India, they have yet to go beyond the IIMs and IITs, I believe, you know. These are all examples of tribalism. So you really, the old world was really about it was really about ensuring that you had the right people in place, that you people had come from the right background. It was about maintaining power. It was actually asserting control. Now, in the new world, this is changing. Why is that changing? Is I think, as one of the gentlemen pointed out, that technology or computing power is actually in the hands of many more people, and it's also falling in price. So technology is shaping this world. It is democratizing a lot of things. I'll come to the next slide. The other thing which is also increasing is people are also tasting more freedom. The average person is more free in a sense than before. You know, it's more free in terms of the choices that he can exert in terms of consumer behavior and so on and so forth. And the other point is that away from tribalism, you know, people are now actually becoming a part of the equation. Earlier, decisions were made by power structures, by people in positions of power. Now, people are becoming more and more important. People's views, the average person's views, are beginning to take into account. And this is happening not just in companies, but even if you look at totalitarian governments like in China, that they can't really do the kind of draconian things that they used to do, let's say, 10, 15 years ago. Now, they have to go through some kind of a vetting process with the general public. So some of the trends which are driving these changes is one is that there's a democratization of wealth and information. Again, information is being democratized because of the cost of computing coming down. Wealth actually is because education is spreading very fast and among newer segments. So people are getting wealthier. Newer segments of people are getting wealthier in that sense than ever before. So and this is happening around the world. Then the other interesting trend is the mobility of talent, which is that earlier, if you were, you know, you would work in the place where you were born. But now, you know, so many people are traveling and living in other cities, in other parts of the world, that the demographic composition of those cities, of those countries is changing dramatically. And the fourth point is there's an increase in the participation of non-traditional participants in the economy, the non-elites. Earlier, there were people who were really in the positions of power were from a specific class, a specific group. But today, I think newer people, newer entrants are coming in, minorities, women, and this is across the board and across. And this is changing the face of the economy as a whole. So in this particular case, you can clearly understand that if you're a business, then there's a change in the approach of running a business. The older approach, which was again coming down from the three or four factors that I listed earlier, was largely a command and control methodology. I know best mentality. I'm the boss, so I know best. So you had better follow what I'm doing. The third thing is employees, managers, suppliers, and customers were considered as separate blocks, separate entities. They were dealing from each other, and they were dealt with separately. So hardly, as a business, you would hardly know the customer, you know, because there's so many of them. You had no personal connection with them, you know. Suppliers were these guys who would hang around your office looking for contracts, and they were more like pests in that sense, you know. And employees and managers were, of course, part of the circle. What was important in running a business was predictability. You know, you had to make sure that your systems and processes were running smoothly. And that was more important than actually ensuring excellence. Excellence was above and beyond that, you know. But you had to make sure that everything was working right. The hygiene was really at the core of the business. Today, however, there is a difference. The big difference is that consumers, employees, managers, and suppliers are actually being looked upon as one entity. So that's the reason is that today's consumer could actually be your manager or your employee tomorrow. Who knows, you know. He could also be a supplier, for all you know. Similarly, a supplier can also be a consumer, can also be an employee. And these roles can actually overlap with one another. And therefore, there is there's a community of around this entire brand, around the company, which is, I think, more important today than ever before. And within the business, collaboration, of course, becomes more important than the command and control method, because with collaboration, you can actually come up with far more newer and better improvements. Continuous innovation and a focus on excellence is also primary drivers now. If you look at some of the values in terms of how the old world operated and how the new world operates, then essentially, you know, recapping, the three main values that are operating now are openness, excellence, and creativity. These are three values which are very, very important today in the modern organization. An example of how this is in place is startup accelerator in San Francisco called Y Combinator. And it's basically a hub where a lot of different startups from around the world come together, and they receive all kinds of help within this framework, all kinds of mentorship, and they also can pitch for funds. Y Combinator doesn't hire any of these entities. That's the interesting point to note. They are essentially cherry-picked through an open competition round. Now, the interesting thing is that this is an open model that's working, where no one really is permanently employed by any of these. I do believe that this model actually is an interesting model for organizations to emulate, because the earlier model was where everyone who was working in an organization was essentially looking at the organization for security, for cradle-to-grave benefits. But in tomorrow's day and age, is it inconceivable for the employee to actually be a service provider who uses the organization as a hub to actually grow his business? And the organization itself actually creates various networks of individuals and entities that can actually take part and facilitate its growth. This, I do believe, while this idea is a bit ahead of its time, I do believe it has a potential of actually of catching on in the years to come. Now, how do you design this kind of an innovative workplace, a workplace where you encourage people to think differently? Well, there are a few counterintuitive things. You know, some people say that within the same organization, if you're a law firm, for example, you know, hire people with a law background. Or if you're a media company, hire people from contiguous industries. But I would actually say that what is more important than the background is actually the values of the of the individual. The values need to be checked very, very, very carefully to see whether they're a fitment with the organization. Beyond that, why not hire from diverse backgrounds? You know, and an example that I've seen working in this is in the case of Xerox in California, where Xerox actually has come up with groundbreaking innovations over the last 30 years, such as the LED screen, such as even the personal computer. And one of the processes it has in place is it actually has created an environment where it ropes in people from various backgrounds, like social scientists, designers, engineers, and technologists, and they just let them free to collaborate and interact with one another and come up with ideas. And I think that kind of an open culture of people mixing from different backgrounds is very, very important in this case, because it brings in different perspectives. Within this, I do feel that you know, a good balance between, therefore, a left brain and a right brain kind of a setup is important. In many consulting companies, for example, the orientation, like in McKinsey, you know, they hire mostly engineers and management professionals. So there's a homogeneity in the kind of thinking. I actually ask them, why don't you hire great designers, great artists, writers, filmmakers into your mix? You know, just because they are from that field doesn't mean that, because they bring in a different perspective. And the reason why they said that they didn't do it is because they don't have an ability to actually evaluate quality in that case. So that therein, they felt there was a limitation there. Transparency of processes and fairness is very important, because the old structure of the company was hierarchical, and incentives were driven largely on the basis of perception. But I think, you know, when transparency comes in, and when everything incentives are offered in that kind of a fashion, then greater acceptance is likely. So the two current models, both one in India and one in Google, where innovation is actually being pursued, in a fairly serious level by within companies, is in Tech Mahindra and in Google. Of course, these two models actually still lie at the outskirts of the business, at the fringe of the business, rather than within the business structure itself. So the companies as a whole, the processes by and large run similar, but beyond what they are doing, I think they encourage employees to, like Mahindra encourages employees to actually start up their own companies, and then they fund them, just like a VC does. And Google actually allows every employee 20% of its time to pursue a personal project. So these are ways in which companies actually encourage their employees to think differently. But I do believe that fundamentally, if you really look at it this way, that the way companies work has not really changed significantly in actually the last 300, 400 years. The idea of the organization itself has remained fairly static. And in order to change this, there needs to be a complete transformation in the way people work, in the way incentives are awarded, in the way ideas and knowledge are shared. And this is one example in which or one model you can say in which this could work is to turn the company into a reality show. Is it possible, for example, where continuous ideas, continuous suggestions, continuous projects can actually be floated and evaluated in an atmosphere in a festive atmosphere. So if an environment like that can be created and it can be sustained throughout the year, similar to what we have in the Durga Puja, or for that matter, we have experimented this in the case of ABP with the Cadbury Mishti Festival, then there's a great potential for this habit to actually become a behavior. And in order for long-term success, I do believe that this desire for innovation needs to be translated into a behavior on the ground. Thank you very much. That was very useful.
Thank you, Aritra. Some very fascinating thoughts out there. Ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end of our session. Unfortunately, we started out a little late, and we are around 3 to 4 minutes behind schedule. So may I request that we take the question and answer session offline? I'm sure that the speakers will be there, and perhaps you can catch them up over discussions during the day. So with that, we call this session to a conclusion. I think one of the things that we take away from this, from all the speakers, is that what is essential in innovation is to develop a culture of innovation, is to develop an openness, the ability to think out of the box, to think and ask questions which are not perhaps just relevant for today, for business as usual, but what the future of the business is going to be. Remember, Google as a company is now getting into insurance. I don't think anyone ever thought about that when Google started out in 1998. So the first question that perhaps you need to ask yourself is that where is your next competitor going to come from? It could well be coming from an industry where the competitor is not at all present. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and with that I call this session to a conclusion.
Thank you very much, Chairperson and Speaker. We'd like to present mementos. May I request Mr. K.K. Mahapatra, Organizing Secretary, INFOCOM, and Associate Vice President of IT Infrastructure Business, ABP Private Limited, to present mementos to our Chairperson and Speakers here for this very interesting session. We thank you. Mr. Aritra Sarkar, Mr. Indrajit Sanyal, and our chairperson, Mr. Rajeshri Sengupta. Thank you very much, sir, for a very, very interesting session. We hope our delegates will take the questions offline.